We played war during the war, Margaret. Toy soldiers were in big demand, the kind made from clay. The lead ones, they melted into bullets, I suppose. You never saw anything as beautiful as those clay regiments. I used to lie on the floor for hours staring them in the eye. I remember them staring back at me in wonder. How strange they must have felt standing stiffly at attention before a large, incomprehending creature with a mustache made of milk. In time they broke, or I broke them on purpose. There was wire inside their limbs, inside their chests, but nothing in their heads. Margaret, I made sure, nothing at all in the heads. Just an arm, now and then, an officer's arm, wielding a saber from a crack in my deaf grandmother's kitchen floor.
La guerra grande. Jugamos a la guerra durante la guerra, Margaret. Los soldados de juguete estaban de moda, los que se hacían con arcilla. Los de plomo se derritieron para hacer balas, supongo. Nunca se ha visto algo tan hermoso como aquellos regimientos de arcilla. Yo solía acostarme en el piso durante horas a mirarlos a los ojos. Los recuerdo devolviéndome la mirada, maravillados. Qué raros debieron sentirse, erguidos en formación, ante una criatura incomprensiva con un bigote de leche. Con el tiempo se rompieron, o yo los rompí a propósito. Tenían alambre dentro de sus extremidades, dentro de sus pechos, pero nada en las cabezas. Margaret, me aseguré de ello. Absolutamente nada en las cabezas. Solo un brazo de vez en cuando. Un brazo de oficial empuñando un sable desde una grieta en el piso de la cocina de mi abuela sorda.
The next poem is an old New York poem. I came to New York from Chicago by myself in 1958, in the summer of 1958. I realized, you know, shortly after that I really didn't know anybody in the city. So, I mean, there was the temptation to go back to Chicago, but I was afraid to go back because my friends would have told me, you know, look, I told you, you don't know anybody in New York. You know? So anyway, this is a description of this kind of wonderful early months in New York, and it has a very strange title because, this is the only book I had at the time, and I was reading, called St. Thomas Aquinas. It was a book of writings of St. Thomas Aquinas. I left parts of myself everywhere, the way absent-minded people leave gloves and umbrellas whose colors are sad from dispensing so much bad luck. I was on a park bench asleep. It was like the art of ancient Egypt. I didn't wish to bestir myself. I made my shadow take I made my long shadow take the evening train. We give death to a child when we give it a doll, said a woman who had read Juna Barnes. We whispered all night. She had traveled to darkest Africa. She had many stories to tell me about the jungle. I was already in New York looking for work. It was raining as in the days of Noah. I stood in many doorways of that great city. Once I asked a man in a tuxedo for a cigarette. He gave me a frightened look and stepped out into the rain. Since man naturally desires happiness, according to St. Thomas Aquinas, who gave irrefutable proof of God's existence and purpose, I loaded trucks in the garment center. A black man and I stole a woman's red dress. It was of silk. It shimmered. Upon a gloomy night, with all our loving ardors on fire, we carried it down the long empty avenue, each holding one sleeve. The heat was intolerable, causing many terrifying human faces to come out of hiding. In the public library reading room, there was a single ceiling fan barely turning. I had the travels of Herman Melville to serve me as a pillow. I was on a ghost ship with its sails fully raised. I could see no land anywhere. The sea and its monsters could not cool me. I followed a saintly-looking nurse into a doctor's office. We edged past people with eyes and ears bandaged. I'm a medieval philosopher in exile, I explained to my landlady that night. And in truth, I no longer look myself. I wore glasses with a nasty spider crack over one eye. I stayed in the movies all day long. A woman on the screen walked through a bombed city again and again. She wore army boots. Her legs were long and bare. It was cold, whatever she was. She had her back turned to me, but I was in love with her. I expected to find wartime Europe at the exit. It wasn't even snowing. Everyone I met wore a part of my destiny like a carnival mask. I'm Bartleby the Scrivener, I told the Italian waiter. Me too, he replied. And I could see nothing but overflowing ashtrays the human face flies were busy examining.
Santo Tomás de Aquino. Dejé partes de mí por todos lados, del modo en que las personas distraídas dejan guantes y paraguas de colores, entristecidos por repartir tanta mala suerte. Yo dormía sobre el banco de un parque, como en el arte del antiguo Egipto, ni me inmuté. Obligué a mi larga sombra a tomar el tren de la tarde. Damos muerte a un niño cuando le damos un muñeco, dijo la mujer que había leído a Juana Barnes. Susurramos toda la noche. Ella había viajado al África más oscura. Tenía muchas historias que contar sobre la jungla. Yo ya estaba en Nueva York buscando trabajo. Llovía como en los tiempos de Noé. Me detuve bajo muchos portales de la gran ciudad. Una vez le pedí un cigarrillo a un hombre en smoking. Me miró espantado y se alejó bajo la lluvia. Dado que el hombre por naturaleza desea la felicidad, según Santo Tomás de Aquino, que probó irrefutablemente la existencia de Dios y su propósito, yo cargaba camiones en el Garment Center. Un negro y yo robamos el vestido de una mujer. Era de seda, resplandecía. Llegada una noche sombría, con todos nuestros tiernos fervores encendidos, lo llevamos por la avenida desierta. Cada uno sostenía una manga. El calor insufrible provocaba la aparición de caras humanas aterradoras. En la sala de lectura de la biblioteca pública había un solo ventilador y apenas giraba. Los viajes de Herman Melville me servían de almohada. Yo iba a bordo de un barco fantasma con las velas izadas y no veía tierra firme por ninguna parte. El mar y sus monstruos no lograron refrescarme. Seguía a una enfermera angelical al consultorio de un doctor. Pasamos muy cerca de personas con los ojos y los oídos vendados. Soy un filósofo medieval en el exilio, le expliqué a mi casera esa noche. Y a decir verdad, ya no me parecía a mí mismo. Llevaba lentes, una grieta en forma de telaraña sobre un ojo. Pasé todo el día en el cine. En la pantalla, una mujer caminaba a través de una ciudad bombardeada una y otra vez. Calzaba botas militares, las piernas largas y desnudas. Hacía frío allí. Me daba la espalda, pero yo estaba enamorado de ella. Esperaba toparme con la Europa de la guerra al salir. Ni siquiera estaba nevando. Toda la gente con que me crucé vestía una parte de mi destino, como una máscara de carnaval. Soy Bartleby, el escribiente, le dije al mesero italiano. Yo también, respondió. Yo no vi nada más que ceniceros, desbordándose, moscas con rostros humanos. Examinándolos.
Thank you. This is called What the Gypsy Stole My Grandmother While She Was Still a Young Girl. War, illness, and famine will make you their favorite grandchild. You'll be like a blind person watching a silent movie. You'll chop onions and pieces of your heart into the same hot skillet. Your children will sleep in a suitcase tied with a rope. Your husband will kiss your breasts every night as if they were two gravestones. Already the crows are grooming themselves for you and your people. Your oldest son will lie with flies on his lips without smiling or lifting his hand. You'll envy every ant you meet in your life and every roadside weed. Your body and soul will sit on separate stoops chewing the same piece of gum. Little cutie, are you for sale, the devil will say. The undertaker will buy a toy for your grandson. Your mind will be a hornet's nest even on your deathbed. You will pray to God, but God will hang a sign that he is not to be disturbed. Question no further, that's all I know.
Lo que las gitanas le dijeron a mi abuela cuando todavía era una muchacha. La guerra, la enfermedad y el hambre harán de ti su nieta preferida. Serás como un ciego viendo una película muda. Picarás sobre la misma sartén caliente cebollas y pedazos de tu corazón. Tus hijos dormirán en una valija atada con una soga. Tu marido te besará los pechos cada noche como si fueran dos lápidas. Ya los cuervos se acicalan para ti y los tuyos. Tu hijo mayor yacerá con moscas sobre los labios, sin sonreír ni levantar la mano. Envidiarás a cada hormiga que se cruza en tu vida y a cada hierbajo a la orilla de la carretera. Tu cuerpo y tu alma se sentarán en portales separados, masticando el mismo chicle. Muñeca, ¿estás a la venta? Dirá el diablo. El sepulturero comprará un juguete para tu nieto. Tu mente será el nido de un avispón, incluso en tu lecho de muerte. Le rezarás a Dios, pero Dios colgará un letrero. No moleste. No más preguntas. Eso es todo lo que sé.
This is called Paradise Motel. Millions were dead. Everybody was innocent. I stayed in my room. The president spoke of war as of a magic love potion. My eyes were open in astonishment. In a mirror, my face appeared to me like a twice-canceled postage stamp. I lived well, but life was awful. There were so many soldiers that day, so many refugees crowding the roads. Naturally, they all vanished with a touch of the hand. History licked the corners of its bloody mouth. On the pay channel, a man and a woman were trading hungry kisses and tearing off each other's clothes, while I looked on with the sound off and the room dark, except for the screen where the color had too much red in it, too much pink.
Hotel Paraíso. Habían muerto millones, todos inocentes. Me quedé en mi cuarto. El presidente habló de la guerra como de una poción mágica de amor. Mis ojos se abrieron de asombro. En el espejo, mi rostro parecía un sello doblemente cancelado. Viví bien, pero la vida era pésima. Había tantos soldados ese día, tantos refugiados, abarrotando las calles. Naturalmente, todos se desvanecieron con un toque de mano. La historia se lamió las comisuras de la boca sangrienta. En el canal de pago, un hombre y una mujer intercambiaban besos hambrientos y se arrancaban la ropa mientras yo miraba, con el sonido apagado y el cuarto a oscuras, salvo por los colores en la pantalla, demasiado rojo, demasiado rosado.
I finished with a couple of poems from actually the most recent book. This is just called In That Big House. When she still knew how to make shadows speak by sitting with them a long time, they talked about her handsome father, his long absence, and how the quiet would fill the house on snowy evenings. Tell us, child, are you afraid? They'd ask. While the girl listened for steps in the hallway, the long, dim one was a full-length mirror that's been going blind like her grandmother, who could no longer find or thread a needle. As she sat in the parlor, remembering some actress her son brought to dinner one night, the one young woman who wandered off by herself and was found later after a long search, floating naked in the black water of the pond.
En aquella casa grande, cuando aún sabía hacer hablar a las sombras, bastaba con sentarse junto a ellas durante largo rato. Le hablaban de su padre guapo, su larga ausencia, y cómo la quietud solía llenar la casa en tardes de nieve. «Cuéntanos, niña, ¿tienes miedo?», le preguntaban, mientras la chica quedaba a la espera de escuchar pasos en el largo y oscuro pasillo, cuyo espejo de cuerpo entero ha ido quedándose ciego como su abuela, que ya no podía encontrar ni enhebrar una aguja, sentada en el salón recordando a los actores que su hijo trajo a cenar una noche. Aquella mujer joven que salió sola sin rumbo y luego hallaron, después de una larga búsqueda, flotando desnuda en las aguas negras del estanque.
Final poem called Puppet Maker, blasphemous poems. I mean, they picked out these poems. I have nothing to do with it. This is called Puppet Maker. In his fear of solitude, he made us. Fearing eternity, he gave us time. I hear his white cane thumping up and down the hall. I expect neighbors to complain, but no. The little girl who sobbed when her daddy crawled into her bed is quiet now. It's 1:45, and the street of darkened pawn shops, welfare hotels and tenements, 1 or 2 ragged puppets awake. Thank you very much. And thank you, translators.